In the second session, first session we discussed about the various basic concepts for the introduction of GST. Now we will discuss about the inception of GST, how GST came into force, when was the discussion started in our country on bringing GST into force. In the first session I told you regarding the concept of input tax credit, how input tax credit helps us to reduce the cost, etc. So that flow of GST also I will explain you in these sessions. So let's start with the session 2. Inception and flow of GST. Now, GST came into force from 2017, but the discussions have happened from many long years on this. So if you see, first in the year 2000, the then Prime Minister introduced this concept of GST and set up a committee to design a GST model for a country. So it was way back in 2000 when the initial discussion on GST was started. Thereafter in 2003-04, they had set up a Vijay Kelkar committee. A task force was set up for this GST. So if you see in 2003-04, the central government formed a task force under Vijay Kelkar, which in 2004 strongly recommended fully integrated GST on a national basis. Thereafter, in 2006-07, the Union Finance Minister, Shri P. Chidambaram, while presenting the Union Budget 6-7, announced that GST would be introduced from 1st April 2010. So, during the budget, he had announced that from 2010, we will implement GST in our country. Finally, in 2017, we had this GST law. Since then, GST had missed several deadlines because the initial discussion started in 2000. Because it's not only India, many countries across the world already have implemented GST. And we have implemented only in 2017. Instead, France was the first country which implemented GST in 1954. So, finally, 1st July 2017, by achieving consensus on all the issues relating thereto. Why it was a little difficult to implement GST? Because all the states had to agree. Because GST is a single law, right? GST is a single legislation, single law. So, to implement the law, all the states have to give their consensus so that a uniform law can be brought into India. So, GST was implemented finally from 1st July 2017. There are different acts and everything, those and all we'll keep discussing. Under GST itself, we have different acts that we'll keep discussing one by one. So, on 27 March 2017, the central CGST legislations, the central GST legislations bill, CGST bill, IGST bill, UTGST bill and GST compensation bill. See, what is this CGST, SGST? We have discussed in the first session. I have given a basics of what is CGST, what is SGST, etc. Right? So these bills, CGST, IGST, UTGST bills and GST compensation to states bill were introduced in Lok Sabha. Lok Sabha passed these bills on 29 March 2017 and with the receipts of the President assent on 12th April 2017, the bills were enacted. The enactment of the central acts was followed by the enactment of the state acts by various state legislatures. Why so? See, central government had passed this, but we discussed in the first session that every state government, there's a separate SGST act, right? So every state legislature also had to pass that. Every state government also had to pass that respective act, right? Then what were the first states, initial states who implemented this? So Telangana, Rajasthan, Chhattisgarh, Goa, Bihar were among the first states to pass their respective state GST in the respective assemblies. So every state in the respective assemblies, they had to pass the respective legislation. By 30th June 2017, all states had passed except J&K. All states and union territories had passed their respective SGST Act and UTGST Act except Jammu and Kashmir. And it's not that Jammu and Kashmir did not implement, they also did it on after 7 days on 8th of July. So Jammu and Kashmir, GST Act extends to Jammu and Kashmir also. In Jammu and Kashmir also GST is applicable. With effect from 1st July 2017, in historic indirect tax reform, GST was introduced and GST was extended to Jammu and Kashmir on, as I said, 8th July 2017. So in Jammu and Kashmir also it was extended on 8th July 2017. What was the need for GST? As I also earlier explained, earlier we had a lot of disadvantages. There were a lot of hiccups in the earlier law. So that is the reason there was a need to implement GST. So let's understand one by one what were the deficiencies in the earlier regime. So deficiencies in the value added taxation system, VAT system. One, in the earlier regime, a manufacturer of excisable goods charged excise duty and VAT on intrastate sales of goods. What is intrastate? Local supplies within the state. See what happened in the earlier law? On manufacture, there was excise duty. We discussed in the first session, right? When I manufacture goods, I pay excise duty. And those manufactured goods, when I sell, I will charge to my customers excise duty and also sales tax, which was called as VAT, within the same state. But if I used to sell outside the state, I will charge excise duty plus something called as central sales tax. Basically, it was CST. So within the same state, I used to charge VAT. Outside the state, I used to charge CST. So there was excise duty and also there was sales tax. Sales tax, either value-added tax or in the form of central sales tax. So there was a tax on tax, right? Multiple taxes were being levied. So let's say earlier regime, a manufacturer excisable goods used to charge excise duty and also VAT. Under earlier indirect tax structure, the various indirect taxes being levied were not necessarily mutually exclusive. What is the meaning of mutually exclusive? It means just because one tax has come, it's not that another indirect tax will not come. They are not mutually exclusive, because on a single invoice, I will charge excise duty also, and I will charge VAT also, I will charge sales tax also. So on a single transaction, single invoice, both the taxes are coming. They were not mutually exclusive. Whereas in GST law, once you levy GST, only GST will come. So earlier what used to happen, when I manufacture a laptop and sell you. So let's say I'm a HP company, I manufacture laptops and I sell laptops. So when I sell laptops, I will charge excise duty. So let's say example, 100 rupees is the product, value of the product. On 100 rupees, I will charge tax. On 100 rupees, I will charge excise duty. And 100 rupees plus excise, on that I will charge VAT. So VAT was a tax on tax also. 100 rupees product, excise duty, let's say 12 rupees 50 paise on that 12.5%. So 112 rupees 50 paise, 112 50 paise. On that I will charge VAT. So what happened? Tax on tax. So these taxes were not mutually exclusive. Just that one indirect tax has come, another can also come. They were not mutually exclusive. Mutually exclusive means if something comes, then another tax should not come in the form of indirect tax. But earlier these were not mutually exclusive. One tax, another tax also. So in the same invoice, multiple taxes were levied. So what happens? Ultimately, the prices of the product were expensive. Despite the introduction of taxation of value added in India, that is SenVAT and state VAT. SenVAT is generally excise duty. There was earlier central excise also. There was state VAT also. Its application has remained piecemeal and fragmented on account of the following reasons. So what were the reasons? What was the need felt for implementation of GST? Non-inclusion of several local levies in state VAT, such as luxury tax and entertainment tax. So as I explained in the first session, multiple taxes were levied by the central government as well as state government. State government used to levy entertainment tax, luxury tax, entry tax, octroi. Multiple taxes were being levied. Now all these taxes have been subsumed into one law, which is GST. So now we don't have so many multiple taxes by the central and state government. All these majority of the taxes have been subsumed into a single law, which is GST. So earlier, multiple tax, a taxpayer has to comply with so many provisions of different laws. It becomes complicated, right? So earlier, there was non-inclusion of several levies into VAT. So what they are trying to say is, there was non-inclusion because all these acts, all the duties, taxes were separate. There was not a uniformity. It was not consumed into a single law. So non-inclusion of several local levies in state VAT, such as luxury tax, entertainment, etc. Because all these are not included into one. All were separate levies. Octroi also separate. Entry tax, advertisement tax. So these are multiple taxes in the earlier law. Now all these taxes are subsumed into one law. There is no more luxury tax, no more entertainment tax by the state government. But please note, as I explained in the first session, entertainment tax levied by local bodies still exist. So when you go and watch movie in a theater, you pay some entertainment tax which is levied by local bodies, because what is levied by local bodies is still not subsumed in GST law. Entertainment tax levied imposed by state government is subsumed in GST, but entertainment tax levied by local bodies like municipal corporation, etc., municipality, these are not subsumed in GST. So state levies, all are subsumed in GST law. So earlier various issues, now all these are clubbed into one law, GST. Next, no SenVat after manufacturing stage. See, what is this SenVat? As I was saying here also, SenVat is basically when you manufacture goods you supply to someone else. Then excise duty, we can take SenVat credit. SenVat credit is basically input tax credit. There's a concept of input tax credit, right? This input tax credit, in GST we call as input tax credit. In earlier regime, central excise, we used to call as SenVat credit. So earlier what happened, no input tax credit of SenVat cannot be taken. So only if you see, no SenVat after manufacturing stage. So I am a manufacturer, I repeat, HP company, I was giving example of HP company, or let's say example, Ashok Leyland is manufacturing commercial vehicles, trucks, lorries, etc. So Ashok Leyland is a manufacturer. So when Ashok Leyland will manufacture this truck, for manufacturing this truck, he will purchase a lot of raw materials from manufacturer. So manufacturer will charge him excise duty, he will take SenVat credit, he will take input tax credit, and he sells these commercial vehicles. When he sells these commercial vehicles, he will also charge excise duty. Against that, he will take SenVat credit, input tax credit of this excise duty. But when Ashok Leyland sells this vehicle to his dealer, the dealer will buy commercial vehicles from him and sell it to the customers or to the other showrooms. In that case, the other person will not charge any excise duty, because excise duty was levied only at the stage of manufacture. I repeat, excise duty was leviable, chargeable only at the stage of manufacture of goods, only at the stage of manufacture. So thereafter, when the goods used to come to dealer, manufacturer, when the Ashok Leyland charges excise duty to the dealer cannot take input tax credit, cannot take SenVat credit of the excise duty charged by the manufacturer, because he is not a manufacturer. Ashok Leyland being a manufacturer, when I purchase from someone else, other manufacturer, I can take excise credit because I have output liability of excise, so I can take input tax credit. But when the dealer of commercial vehicles purchases trucks from lorries, commercial vehicles from Ashok Leyland, the dealer cannot take input tax credit, because dealer cannot charge excise duty to his customers. Dealer can charge only sales tax in earlier law. I am talking about earlier regime. So Ashok Leyland can charge excise duty, Ashok Leyland can take credit, but the dealer who is purchasing from Ashok Leyland, he cannot take input tax credit of that excise duty. So earlier there was no SenVat credit after the manufacturing stage. So only I say, because up to manufacturing stage, up to Ashok Leyland, I can take input tax credit. But after that said, no input tax credit. Let's take other examples. Laptop. Let's say HP company, when they manufacture laptops, they might purchase a lot of parts from manufacturer. So manufacturers will charge them excise duty to HP. HP company will take input tax credit, because when the HP company sells laptops to the distributor, they will charge him excise duty, and they will claim input tax credit, SenVat credit of the excise duty charged by the vendors to them. But when the HP company sells this laptop to the distributor, distributor cannot take input tax credit. Distributor will sell to dealer, dealer to ultimate customer. Input tax credit, SenVat credit is not eligible. So SenVat credit is eligible only at manufacturing stage. In the earlier regime, we are talking about earlier law. In GST, input tax credit is applicable, available, right from the manufacturing stage till the end stage, till the before it reaches the end customer, or everyone in the business cycle can take input tax credit. In GST, everyone can take input tax credit. The manufacturer, distributor, dealer, wholesaler, retailer, all these can take input tax credit. There is no blockage anywhere. There is a continuous flow of transaction. I will show you the flow of transaction in certain slides. Flow of transaction is there. Right from the manufacturer, distributor, dealer, wholesaler to retailer, everyone can take input tax credit of GST. Earlier law, because there was an excise duty, there was a VAT, there was service tax, multiple issues were there in the earlier law. So only these were the deficiencies in the earlier law, which were curbed into GST law. Non-integration of VAT and service tax. What is this non-integration of VAT and service tax? Let me give an example of a chartered accountant. So a chartered accountant is having his office. I repeat, a chartered accountant is having its office. So he's providing consultancies to his clients. In the earlier law, before GST came in the picture, the chartered accountant would have charged to his clients what tax? Service tax. because he was providing services to his clients. So he would have levied service tax to his clients. But what tax he would have got levied from his suppliers? What expenditure generally chartered accountant will have? He will have an office, right? An office which will be on rent. So the landlord will charge him service tax on service transaction, service, that input tax credit. Landlord on that, he can take input tax credit, yes. Now, a CA might purchase some furniture, some table chairs for his office, computer laptops for his office, CPU. So when he purchases computers, laptops and all, earlier law, the vendor will charge him sales tax, because on sale of goods, it was sales tax. So when he purchases from a showroom, some furniture, table chair, computer laptops, the vendor will charge him sales tax. Can he take input tax credit in the earlier law? Was he eligible? No, because input tax credit is VAT on goods. But he used to bill customers only service tax. So sales tax cannot be taken input tax credit in the service tax. Service tax is levied by central government. Sales tax levied by state government. How will we take input tax? We cannot take input tax credit. So earlier there was no integration. I'll give another example. Let's say Big Bazaar. Big Bazaar is selling products. So earlier, before GST, what he would have done? He might be charging sales tax on all the goods. So when you go to Big Bazaar, you buy furniture items, you buy consumable durables, you buy garments, you buy anything and everything. Big Bazaar will charge you sales tax, because he was not providing service, he was selling only goods. Only sales tax, VAT on his bills. But on his procurement side, he will purchase goods. So vendors will charge him VAT, he will take credit. But certain vendors like rent, he might have a huge rent cost. So landlord will charge him service tax, earlier law. Landlord will charge him service tax on the service bill. Chartered accountant will charge him service tax on his service bill. AMC contracts will charge him service tax on his bills. When Big Bazaar is paying so much service tax to the vendors, can he take input tax credit of that service tax? He cannot take, because output liability is only sales tax. Because he is having only sales tax liability, because he is selling only goods. So liability is in sales tax. Input tax rate in service tax, both cannot be integrated, both cannot be taken input tax rate. So all this was a cost. But in GST law, please focus, in GST law, there is no hardships here. It is all integrated. Integrated GST. What happens? Let me go back to my example of a chartered accountant. Now what will happen in GST? Chartered accountant, when he is providing service to his clients, he will charge GST. No service tax, no VAT. So when no goods, no service, he is providing a service to his clients, transaction. I mean to say, no service tax, no sales tax. When he is providing service to his clients, he will charge GST. When he procures services, let's say example, landlord, even he is receiving rent service, landlord will charge him GST. When he purchases computers, laptops for his office, furniture for his office, the vendors will charge him GST. So input side, whether it is service or goods, all GST. And outward side, it's all GST, all can be integrated, input tax rate can be taken. So I hope you are able to understand and appreciate the principles and the reason because of which GST was implemented. So earlier there was no integration. VAT cannot be adjusted against service tax, nor service tax can be adjusted against VAT. But in GST, these problems are not there. I give you an example of a CA office also. I give you an example of a dealer of goods also. Now both can take input tax credit. Let's take another example. A distributor of goods having a huge godown, huge warehouse. He was dealer of goods. He used to charge sales tax in the earlier to his clients. When the landlord used to charge him service tax, his auditor used to charge him service tax. He could not take credit of all these items because the landlord used to charge him service tax. Liability was in VAT, no credit. But now what happens? GST, the trader, distributor, wholesaler, they will charge GST on sale of goods. Input tax rate also will be all GST, whether it is service or it is goods. Whether it is landlord service or he purchased raw materials, everywhere there is GST, output also GST, all input output can be taken. So that's the beauty of GST. So earlier no integration, now there is no integration. There is complete integration. Double taxation of a transaction as both goods and service. What is this double tax? If you see the word double taxation, that means there was a double tax on a single transaction. Like, let me give an example of construction service. See, when you do a construction, on construction, what tax we pay? See, when I do a construction is goods or service. Please think about it. Construction activity, just imagine a construction. When you do construction, we use cement, we use steel, we use labor contracts, right? Whether construction activity can be called as a goods or can be called as a service. Think about it. Think, are you able to get any answer whether construction is goods or service? Difficult, right? Because construction activity has both goods and service. Similarly, take an example of a restaurant. You go and eat in a restaurant. You sit on the table, you order for food, you call for the menu, the waiter brings the menu and you see the food and you order. Waiter will bring and keep serving you the food. Now, that restaurant where you are going and eating, you are receiving goods or you are receiving service? Can you say anyone whether it is goods or service? Difficult, because you are eating food, which is goods, and you are receiving service because the waiter is coming and serving you. The moment your food is finished, you're calling, waiter, come here. The waiter will come and serve you. So you are getting a service and you are getting food also. So there was a many complications such services and transactions, whether this is goods or this is service. So what happened? If the government feels it is goods, state government will charge, start charging sales tax. If the central government feels it's a service, central government will charge service tax. So your state government is charging sales tax, central government is charging service tax. So in a single transaction, both taxes are being levied. So in the earlier law, we had many complications like this. I've just given you two examples, but there were many complications. See, in a restaurant, you cannot say, when I call the waiter, waiter did not come, so I did not receive good service, it is only goods. General parlance, I'm talking about a general parlance. Restaurant will have both goods and service. Construction will have both and goods and service. So similar transactions, there were a lot of disputes and confusions on the taxability of a transaction. So ultimately, customers are facing the brunt. The taxpayers will face the brunt. But this double taxation issue is not there in GST, because they've clarified certain transactions. When you have a construction activity, they've told in GST that construction is a service. When you have a restaurant service, food service, GST law say, don't fight, please. Restaurant is a service. Don't dispute, don't fight whether it is good service. We are assuming, we are deeming as per law that it is a service. So no issue. Earlier, what happened? State government wants to levy sales tax, they say it is goods. Service, central government wants to levy service tax, they say service. So earlier law, when you go and eat in a restaurant, when you go and eat in a Taj hotel, or you go and eat in any restaurant, in the earlier law, before GST, in the bill you will see service tax also, sales tax also. Service tax will go to central government, sales tax will go to the respective state government. So in GST, in the food bill, you will see only GST. And they have clarified that. Don't fight what is goods, what is service. Wherever there is fight, we will clarify in GST law. So GST law, since in GST law, everything is mutually decided, right? Because decisions are taken by GST Council. GST Council basically is represented by all the state and central government. So all the states will have their representatives, finance ministers in the GST Council. And the union finance minister also will sit in the GST Council. They are all the members of GST Council. And they will mutually decide and take a decision. So in GST, these issues are all curbed in GST law. That is the reason we call GST as a good and simple law. But since many times, many might be doing chartered accountancy course, studying CA course, so or doing articleship, or would have done articleship, would have seen that many clients keep complaining that GST is a very complicated law, GST is a very cumbersome process. See, what happens is any law to implement in India is a challenge, because our country is huge. We have depth of transactions. We have every type of consumers in India. So it is not easy to levy or bring a new levy, which is so huge. So definitely we will have hiccups in the beginning. But going forward, this law will become a beautiful law going forward. Because whenever the government feels that there are some loopholes in the law or there are certain issues in the law, the government is going on clarifying, issuing multiple notifications then and there to keep clarifying various provisions of the GST law, right? So that was the need for GST. Deficiency in the existing value added taxation led to GST. As I said, there are multiple deficiencies in the earlier law which led to the implementation of GST. GST is a path breaking indirect tax reform which will create a common market by dismantling interstate barriers. What is it, interstate barriers? Example. Let's take an example. A company, let's say Ashok Leyland, operating in Tamil Nadu. Ashok Leyland example I'm taking, they are manufacturing commercial vehicles. So they are operating in Tamil Nadu. Now, to manufacture commercial vehicles, they might need certain parts. So they purchase from Maharashtra. I repeat, Ashok Leyland operations factory in Tamil Nadu. They purchased certain raw materials from a state in Maharashtra. So when the Maharashtra party is supplying goods to them, in the earlier I am talking about in the VAT regime, they will charge something called as CST, Central Sales Tax. They will charge excise duty also. If it's a manufacturer, it will charge excise duty. If it's not a manufacturer, they will not charge excise duty. So let's say I am taking purchasing from manufacturers, they will charge excise duty. They will charge VAT also to Ashok Leyland. CST. So when the vendor is charging CST to Ashok Leyland, Ashok Leyland cannot take input tax credit. Excise duty they can take credit, because up to manufacturing state, excise duty credit was allowed. But Ashok Leyland in Tamil Nadu, when they are purchasing goods from outside the state, like from Maharashtra, from Delhi, or from Karnataka or Kerala, those respective states will charge them CST. That CST credit cannot be taken by Ashok Leyland, causing interstate barriers. So that tax becomes a cost to me. But Ashok Leyland, if purchase anything from Tamil Nadu, they will charge him VAT and he can take credit. So purchasing from outside the state, already I will incur transportation cost because I am calling from outside the state, from long distance goods are coming to me. Plus I will incur extra tax also, which is a cost to me. So these are causing a lot of interstate barriers. And in the earlier law, there was something called as check post. When goods are moving from one place to another, everywhere there is check post, like you have toll, right? You are going through, example, let's say highway. So you will find a lot of tolls. So likewise, this check post were there where they will check the movement of goods. So it used to consume a lot of time for the vehicles, because every vehicle will be, majority of the vehicles will be intercepted. They will verify it, whether they have proper documents or not, etc., etc. So there were a lot of interstate barriers in the earlier law. Not in GST. Now after GST, if Ashok Leyland in Tamil Nadu is purchasing goods from Maharashtra, Kerala, Karnataka, Pune, Delhi, Rajasthan, anywhere, they will all charge him only GST. Neither excise duty nor CST. Only GST. That's the reason GST is called as an integrated GST. One nation, one tax. Every state will charge me only GST. Earlier law, multiple taxes, multiple confusions. After implementation of GST, Ashok Leyland in Tamil Nadu, whenever they purchase or where, from wherever they purchase in India, everyone will charge him only GST and he can take full input tax credit. That's the beauty of GST. France, as I said, France was the first country to implement VAT or GST in 1954. And in India, we've implemented in 2017. So already we are very late in the race. So first country to implement this law. See why I mentioned GST or VAT. Some countries call GST as a VAT tax. See, it is only a different form, but the principles are same. Principles are same. So like in India, we call as GST. Some countries call as VAT also. So it is a form people call it. Presently, more than 160 countries have implemented VAT or GST in some form or the other, because this tax has the capacity to raise the government in the most effective and transparent manner. Because earlier law, there were a lot of manual procedures, a lot of hiccups in the transactions, which was, you know, creating multiple issues. GST is a simple law as such from the frame of the GST law, because everything is integrated, everything is GST, things are online. So that will create more transparency, more revenue to the government, and more efficiency to the taxpayers also. GST is a comprehensive tax levy on manufacture, sale and consumption of goods and services at national level. Now, I will explain you the flow of GST. As I said, manufacturer, distributor, dealer, wholesaler, retailer, everyone in the chain can take input tax credit. Unlike in the earlier law, excise duty can be taken only by the manufacturer. In the stage of manufacture, later on we cannot take. No such restriction. Everyone in the supply chain can take input tax credit. Whether it is goods or whether it is service, everything is liable with GST. Whether you are manufacturer, whether you are trader, everyone will charge only GST. Right? Now let me take some figures, numerical figures, and explain you this flow of GST, how it flows and how ITC is being taken. So there are three dealers, dealer A, B and C, in the value chain of supply of goods. So there are three dealers, I'm assuming, A, B and C. Assume the tax rate as 10% in each case. See, presently, practically, there is no rate as 10% in GST law. I've just taken 10% for simplicity of calculation. So assuming a tax rate of 10%, the value addition made by A, B and C is 4 rupees 1000, 4 rupees 500. For what is value addition I'm talking about? When I purchase some goods, I do some processing and sell it, or I purchase and add some margin and sell it. So this is the value addition done by them. So this is the margin, maybe you can say they have added. So Mr. A, value addition for 1000 rupees, Mr. B has done value addition of 500, and Mr. C has done value addition of 300. Determine the total cost on the consumer D. D is who is the end customer. See, in GST, the entire burden is borne by the end customer. I repeat, in GST, the entire burden is borne by the end customer. Like you and me, we bear the entire burden. Because when a manufacturer supplies to a dealer, distributor, wholesaler, everyone will take input tax credit or tax charged by the supplier, and they will collect and pay. See, income tax is paid out of our own pocket. I repeat, income tax, we bear the burden. We bear the burden. So when I earn income, out of my income, I will pay tax to the government. That is income tax. Only we call that as a direct tax. But GST is an indirect tax. I do not bear the burden. I only act as an agent. I collect tax and pay to the government. I collect tax and pay to the government. I do not bear GST from my own pocket. I will not bear out of my own pocket. I will only collect and pay to the government. So ultimately what happens? No one bears GST. No one bears GST. Supplier will charge me GST. I will pay him GST, that I will take as input tax credit. And on sales, when I charge GST to the supplier, what money I already paid to the supplier, I will keep out of that in my pocket. Balance only I will pay to actual government. So nothing I bought out of my own pocket, right? So only we call GST as an indirect tax, because we do not bear the burden. We collect and pay. Who bears the burden? Everyone will keep adding margin. Ultimately, the end customer who is purchasing goods or service, they bear the entire brunt of indirect tax. That's the reality. So let's see in this example. Let's see in the example, I will show you how this consumer D is bearing the entire burden of indirect tax, right? Now, you have to work out the cost to D in two scenarios. Two scenarios you have. One, if there is no credit system, that means, let's say there is no concept of input tax credit at all, or if there is a credit system. So, what we're trying to understand here is, how input tax credit is a game changer, because it makes a huge difference when you allow input tax credit and would not allow input tax credit. So in both these scenarios, we'll see what happens if there is no credit system, what happens if there's a credit system, how it ultimately impacts the government and also the end customer. Let's see. So assuming first, there is no input tax credit system at all. Now, so dealer A, dealer B, and dealer C. So we have assumed three dealers, A, B, and C. Now, so dealer purchase price is zero because he is, let's say, manufacturer of goods. So he is doing a value addition. We discussed in the question, 1000 rupees. Second dealer is doing 500. Third dealer is doing 300. Please remember that 1500, 300, that you have to remember. So value addition is done for 1000 rupees. So he will sell for 1000 rupees. So he is selling for 1000 rupees. Tax rate we have assumed, right? 10%. So on 1000 rupees, there's a tax rate of 10%. So 1000 into 10% is 100 rupees. So I'm selling a product for 1000 rupees. And that I charge 10% tax. So 100 rupees I charge. So my invoice value will be 1000 plus 100, which is 1100, which I collect from the customer. Here, tax rate available for set off is zero because always it will be zero because the scenario which you have assumed is no credit system. There is no concept of input tax credit I have assumed here. So I cannot take any credit, right? So I collect 1100 rupees from the customer. Net tax payable to the government is 100 because no concept of input tax credit. So 100 minus 0, I cannot subtract anything because there is no concept of input tax credit. Whatever I collect, I have to pay the government. So now here, if you see, what has A done? He has collected 100 rupees from the customer, which is B. He has sold to B and he has paid to the government. Did he pay anything out of his own pocket? No. 100 rupees he sold to the customer, plus 1000 rupees he sold to the customer, plus he collected 100 rupees as tax and paid to the government. He did not bear anything. Who is bearing the tax now as of now? B. we will see then B will also not bear tax, that he will burden will shift to the customer. So in the first case we have seen when A is supplying goods, he is charging 1000 rupees plus 100. Now he will pay income tax on 1000 rupees because 1000 rupees he has collected from the customer at his, as his sale price. Out of that he will pay income tax to the government, that he will bear out of his own pocket. But GST is not bearing, GST is collecting 100 rupees and paid to the government. That's his work is over. So now the product comes to B. What is the cost price for B? 1100, because he has paid out of his own pocket 1100 and he cannot take any input tax rate also. So entire 1100 becomes the cost for B. So B purchase price is 1100. Now he does a value addition of rupees 500. So sale price becomes 1600. Right. Now what is the tax rate? 10%. So 160. Sale. So how much he will collect from the customer? 1600 plus 160, which is 1760. So 1760 he collects from the buyer. Buyer means he sells to C. Now how much tax he will pay to the government? He has collected 160. Can he take an input tax rate? No. So entire 160 will collect from the government. So what happens here in this concept? He is collecting 160 from the customer, he is paying to the government. Now this 160 rupees is collecting. Has he borne any tax? No, because he is collecting. What tax is collecting? He is paying to the government. Now here if you see, we are assumed that there is no concept of input tax rate. There is no concept of input tax rate. So accordingly, when the A charge him tax, the tax he should collect from the customer, right? So again, he has added that cost of tax also in his margin. And he is collected from the customer. So now when he is charging the customer on the sale price, he is charging 10% tax. I will show in the next system, when he can take input tax rate, he will not even bear a single rupee. But now what has happened, this 100 rupees charged to B, he has borne the burden, or he would have added in his value addition. He would have added in his value addition because ultimately it's an indirect tax. He will think why I should bear. So on his purchase price 1100 rupees, he knows 100 rupees is cost. So he has taken his purchase price. So let's say his margin is 50, let's say fixed as 50%. He will add margin is 50%. So on that cost price also margin will come, right? So 1600 rupees on that tax rate 10%, 1760. He is paying 160 rupees to the government. Now this invoice comes to C. Now his purchase price is 1760. Now he adds a margin of 300 rupees. He sells for 2060. 10% tax. So he'll charge 206, 10%. So how much he'll collect from the customer? 2060 plus 206. And how much he'll pay tax to the government? 206 rupees. So what is happening? What is happening here? Ultimately, when he's selling to the customer, he's selling for 2060 rupees and he's charging tax of 206 rupees and he's paying to the government. Can he take any input tax? He cannot take input tax. So what is happening? Everyone is increasing their margin because their cost price is increasing. Because if you see B also, his cost price would have been 1000. If you would have taken input tax rate, his cost price would have become 1000. But now he cannot take ITC, so his cost price is 1100. Since his cost has increased, he will add increase his margin and he will sell to the customers because his cost price has increased. Similarly, C also, ultimately cost price is going up for everyone. How much tax government is getting at? 200, 300, 400, 466. So if you see here, amount collected from the customer, end customer, 2266. So end customer is finally bearing 2266 amount, right, cost. And out of that tax amount is 206 rupees. So end customer, how much when C is selling to D, he will charge 2060 plus 206 tax. So how much the customer, anyways, never can take credit. Like you and me, we cannot take any credit. So 2266, out of that tax amount is 206. And the total tax payable to the government is 100 plus 160 plus 206. So this is the total tax paid to the government. So government has got tax of 466. Now let's see the second scenario where there is input tax rate system. Same figures. We'll see what is the net landing cost to the customer D also. Value addition 1000, purchase price is 0. Value addition 1000, sale price 1000 plus 10% tax 100. So he's selling to the customer for 1100 rupees. Now amount available for credit 0 because he has manufactured himself with his own goods. He has not purchased anything. So 100 rupees paid to the government. Next, this invoice comes to B. What is the cost for B? Cost for B will be only 1000 rupees because this 100 rupees he can take input tax credit. So cost is only 1000 because this 100 rupees will again adjust against the output tax liability which is collected from the customer. So this 100 rupees becomes an asset to him because what entry will you will pass in your books of accounts. Purchase account debit 1000 rupees. Input tax rate account debit 100 rupees. So purchase account, it will go only 1000. Input tax rate as an asset will go 100 to supplier account. In your books, you will pass an entry. Purchase account debit 1000 rupees. Input tax rate account debit 100 rupees. So purchase and to supplier account to bank account. So purchase cost is only 1000. So 1000 rupees. So here cost is reducing. Then find it is valuation, fixed valuation. So sale price is 1500. What happened earlier? Earlier in the last case, if you see, his purchase cost was 1100. His margin was fixed because he wants to earn 500 rupees. So what was happening? He was not bearing the tax. The tax was collecting from the end customer ultimately. See, earlier his cost was 1100 rupees. As a businessman, he has decided that on every sale of this product, I will keep 500 rupees margin. So when his cost was 1100 rupees, the sale price became 1600. He did not bear that pocket. His margin was fixed 500. In the earlier example also, when there was no input tax credit system, his margin was 500. Now also he wants to earn 500 rupees. So what happened in the earlier case? He cannot, since no one wants to bear the burden of indirect tax, it's an indirect tax. So what he will do? He will pass that cost to the ultimate customer. So now what happens? His cost is only 1000 rupees. His margin 500. So he's selling to the customer for 1500 rupees. In the earlier example, he took the cost as 1500 because why he will bear the cost? That indirect has a cost, right? So he has to pass that cost to the customer ultimately. So now here if you see, sale price is 1500 rupees, 1000 plus 500. On that 10% tax, 150 rupees. So now, 1500 plus 150 is 1650 rupees. Now, how much tax to be payable to the government in this case? Please understand here, please focus. Input tax rate concept, you will understand if you answer this question. 1500 rupees when he's selling to the customer, he's charging a tax of 150 rupees. So total invoice value, invoice is giving to the customer and collecting from him 1650 rupees. So B has collected 150 rupees as tax from the customer. Out of this 150 rupees, how much he will pay to the government? Or he will keep full 150 rupees in his pocket? Or will he pay full 150 to the government? Will he keep 150 rupees full in his pocket? Or full 150 rupees he will give to the government? What he will do? He will do neither of the two because 150 rupees when he is collecting as tax from the customer, that money is not his money. He has collected from the customer stating tax. Now he will see out of 150 rupees how much I have already paid to my vendor. To my vendor when I purchase goods, how much I paid already? He paid already 100 rupees because his purchase bill is 1000 plus 100. 100 he already paid. So that he can take as input tax rate. So 150 rupees he will collect from his customer. Out of that 100 rupees he will take input tax rate. He will keep in his pocket. Because 100 rupees already he paid to the supplier. Balance 50 will pay to the government. So what is happening? Whether B is bearing any burden of GST? Not at all. On purchase he paid 100 rupees on purchase he paid out of his own pocket. The 100 rupees is indirectly collected from the customer. He collected 150 from the customer. What he already paid he kept on his pocket and balance 50 only paid to the government. Did he bear anything? He did not bear any indirect tax, any GST. Initial that 50 rupees what he paid to the government also is collected from the customer and paid. Alright? So there is no cost. So GST is not a cost to anyone. GST is an indirect tax. You have to collect and pay to the government. Ultimate burden will be by D. We will see here also. Ultimate burden will be borne by D. End customer only will bear the burden of indirect tax. This is the basic principle concept of an indirect tax, specifically now GST. Right? So, as I said, input tax rate available is 100. So how much tax is paying? 150 minus 100. 150 minus 100 only 50. 100 rupees I already paid. Collect 150. 100 which I already paid, keep in my pocket. Balance 50 paid to the government. So out of my pocket, I have not paid any single rupee to the government. Now this bill of 1650 comes to C because B sold to C. So C gets a bill of 1500 rupees plus 150 rupees tax, 1650 rupees. So this bill comes to C. What C does? C will be able to claim input tax rate of 150 rupees, right? Because C has given 150 rupees fully, right? When B sold to C gave him 150 rupees fully. So 150 rupees C will take input tax rate. So the cost for B will be, sorry, the cost for C will be only 1500 rupees. So for C, purchase price is 1500. Because what entry dealer C will part is in the books of accounts? Purchase account debit 1500 rupees. Input tax rate account debit 150 rupees to B account, to supplier account. Right, so 1500 rupees is the cost because 150 he also wants to take input tax, right? Against his sales, he is also adjust, right? Because he is also into business. Now, 1500 rupees is the purchase price, his margin is fixed at 300 rupees. Now, he is selling for 1800 rupees to the customer because purchase price plus value addition 1800 plus he charges a tax of 10%, which is 180. So, it becomes 1980 rupees plus 10% tax, which becomes 1980. Now please think and tell me, 1980 rupees when I'm selling to the customer, ultimate customer, how much tax I'm charging him? 180. So from D, when C is selling to D, he will collect from D 1800 rupees plus 180 rupees as GST tax. So when I'm collecting 180 rupees, will I keep fully in my pocket? I will pay fully to the government. What will I do? 180 rupees I collect from D. Out of that, 150 rupees I have input tax rate which I paid to B. So out of 180, 150 rupees I will keep in my pocket. 30 rupees I will pay to the government. So 180 rupees I collected, 150 rupees is available as input tax rate, because 150 rupees tax he paid to B out of his own pocket. So that is credit. So minus 180 minus 150, 30 rupees only C will pay to the government. So I think with this example, this concept of input tax rate should be very amply be clear to you, right? Now let's compare the difference. Amount collected from the customer is only 1980. In the previous example, it was going about 2200. In the previous example, it was going about 2200. Whereas the ultimate customer, you and me, in this example, we are paying only 1980. So how much savings we are making because of input tax? Because earlier what happened, every customer, every businessman was passing the cost of GST to the ultimate customer. So there is a benefit to end customer. Who is bearing that loss? Government is bearing in terms of tax. So now if you see the total tax received by the government in cash, everyone is paying this tax to the government. How much they pay? Total 100, 150, 180. Total tax collected by the government here is 180 rupees. In the previous example, it was more than 400 rupees. That's the beauty, 400 rupees. So total tax, that is net tax payable to the government, is only 180 rupees. Therefore, transparency is achieved in the system. So this is the entire concept of input tax. So what will happen? Everyone who wants to take input tax rate will show the transaction in the books of accounts. They will do business with transparency, because if this person, example C, sells in cash, does not show this transaction to books of accounts, what will happen? B has given him tax, the tax will become cost to him because he cannot take input tax credit. So let's say example, a dealer is purchasing cement from Ambuja Cement. Ambuja Cement will charge him GST. If he sells this transaction in cash, does not show in books of accounts, then the GST which Ambuja Cement is charging will become a cost. So this will become more transparency, because everyone will want input tax rate in the system. So this is the entire concept of the flow of input tax rate, flow of GST in the system. So analysis, saving to the customer because of GST, because of this input tax rate concept, is how much? 2266 was the net cost borne by the ultimate customer. See, example, as a student, as a CA student, you buy a laptop or a system, computers, to watch online classes, to prepare for exams, to do some research. When you're buying computer or laptop, you pay GST, right? When you buy a computer or laptop, when the vendor will sell you, let's say example, you buy a mobile phone also. When they sell you mobile phone, they will charge you GST. When you buy laptop computers, they will charge you GST. Can you take input tax rate? No, that is the ultimate cost to you. Ultimately, end customer will only bear the burden always. So here if you see, earlier the customer was bearing the cost of 2266. Now the customer is bearing only 1980. So there's a savings to the customers for 286. Loss of revenue to the government will be same, logically, right? So credit system 460 money at 1286. Because earlier scheme, government got a lot of taxes. Now government is getting less tax because there's an input tax rate involved at every stage. Therefore, in the system of credit, the government is losing its revenue to contribute to the customer, end customer, right? So with this, we have completed this concept of flow of transactions in GST. Right from the first businessman A to B to C to D, how the transaction flows from one person to another to another to another till end customer. I have shown you that flow of transaction to understand how GST is depicted in the law, how input tax rate flows, and how there is a smooth flow of transaction from one business to another business in GST. Right? Thank you and take care.